Sunday we want to express our appreciation to the God of heaven, because we know God does all things well. We certainly want to express our appreciation to Brother Dogan tonight for that on point introduction. You see, Brother Dogan and I in that category of men who are over 60 years old. And since the city of Houston has decided that they will cut the water off here tonight, those of us who are over 60, we can't hardly pass by that place where the water is running. So, y'all forgive us tonight for having an abbreviated devotional service, but we gotta pretend like we got some sense tonight. Preaching was up here a long time last night, but tonight I'm gonna be like I got some sense. I said, I don't have much, but I'm gonna be like. You don't believe I got no sense, just ask my wife. She'll tell you he ain't got no sense. But she would love to be here tonight, because it usually takes me 30 minutes just to clear my throat. But the water's not running, so we got to get on. The young folks said, we got Peter, we got to get on down. I said, amen. We want to thank Brother Dogan again for a wonderful job in introducing Sister Holly's husband. We have four children, and they go from 29 to almost 36. We don't have any grandchildren. And so when we leave here tonight, when you open the windows toward Mecca, Jerusalem, or wherever you want toward when you pray, pray that our children can get married and bring us some grandbabies so we can play with them and send them home. Praise the Lord. We want to thank again Brother Tucker for the invitation to come. And we want to thank the bishopric, the Christ Funeral, and the apostle, the elders of this church for consenting for us to come. And certainly we want to thank the people power that sits in the pew. Because without the power that sits in the pew, there would be no church. Be no church to preach to. There would be no church to shepherd. There would be no church to deacon. Y'all know the deacons deacon, don't you? Amen, praise the Lord. We want to express our appreciation for the servants of this church, including the Greek diakonos. That's the deacons, y'all. I said, amen, praise the Lord. We thank God for the deaconesses, too. Those are the sisters who serve, and they may not hold a formal office. But what would you do in the church if there were no sisters? Those of you who knew Papa R.N. Hogan, he would say, if all the sisters were out of the church, I got one more sermon to preach. Finally, brethren, farewell. Amen. Praise the Lord. It's good to see my kinsmen in the house tonight, and Brother Darren Cathy. Amen. We are Southern fellas. Amen. I would say we were Southern boys, but we've gotten older now. And Darren is saying, man, go and take a text because the water ain't running. I said, amen. Praise the Lord. It's good to see everybody here tonight. And we serve a magnificent God. All of the gospel preachers that are in the house, those of you who are here that I may not know, it's good to see you in this place. God had one song. And that one song was a gospel preacher. Good to see Brother Martin in here tonight. We had a tremendous time in fellowship today. Amen. Praise the Lord. You remember when Paul left Athens and went to Corinth, and he was dealing with difficulty over there. And then those other younger preachers showed up, and the text said he was pressed in the spirit. And that's the kind of fellowship we have, one with another. Peter, it's good to see you tonight. And if the water was running, I'd preach tonight. I said, amen, but the water ain't running. In Luke chapter 7, the gospel according to the good physician Lucas, chapter 7. If God be our helper, we commence the reading at verse 1, and we land at verse number 10. Lucas, the church, this is the traveling companion of the pristine Apostle Paul, the wandering itinerant tent maker from Tarsus. What does all that mean? Ask your preacher, he'll explain it to you. In Luke chapter 7, we commence the reading at verse 1, and we'll be culminating at verse number 10. Those of you who are visiting with the South Union Church tonight, we want to welcome you to one of the greatest and most historical churches in our brotherhood. And those of you who are visiting with the Church of Christ tonight, God bless your heart. We want you to receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save and keep saving all of our souls. What a wonderful beautiful series of revival meetings we have had this week. And if Brother Yeldale were living, this would be the night when he would say, we just got one more night. We just got one more night. You do know that Brother Yeldale and Brother Edgar Scott are fast friends, don't you? Amen. I'm sending the gospel to the late, great Dr. McComas Yeldale. Luke 7, we commence at verse 1, and we land at verse number 10. Now, when he, meaning Jesus, had ended all his sayings and the audience of the people, watch this now, he entered into Capernaum. Didn't we deal with Capernaum on last night? And a certain, I like this now, didn't call it sometimes, you know, it has been said sometimes, but Thompson, in Western culture, we're too concerned about the who. And then we get too caught up in personalities, Darren, and we miss the what. Notice now that the centurion in this text is not named. Come on, y'all. Sometimes names are not important. Sometimes we need to get the message about the what, so we're going to get hung up on the who. A certain centurion, what's his name? Don't worry about that. A certain centurion servant who was dear unto him was sick and ready to die. And when this certain centurion, Brother Dogan, when he heard of Jesus, y'all are going to help me tonight. Anybody here tonight heard of Jesus? And when he had heard of Jesus, he said unto him, the elders of the Jews. I mean, these are not young whippersnappers now. These are the elders of Israel who were experiential. These elders that were sent to Jesus had a relationship with Jesus. Lord, this text is just pregnant with so much possibility. When he didn't know Jesus. But when he had heard of Jesus, let me pause. Is Sister Herndon in the audience yet tonight? Sister Herndon, it's good to see you. Amen. This is Sister A.J. Herndon, her husband and I were fast friends. And Sister Herndon, it's shown up good to see you in this house tonight. I would have recognized you earlier, Sister Herndon, but I'm past 60 years old now. Forgettery works real good. Thank you. Is that your daughter, Sister Herndon? Good to see you tonight, baby. Good to see y'all in the house. Let's continue to pray for Sister Herndon. She is a jewel of a lady. And Cecil Bernard Herndon was a jewel of a man and a jewel of a gospel preacher. When he had heard of Jesus, he sent unto him the elders of the Jews, beseeching or begging him that he would come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they besought, they urged or begged him instantly, saying that he was worthy for whom he should do this. For this man loves our nation. And this man has done what some of our nation would not do. Y'all need to come on heaven tonight. This man was an outside, but he was acting like an inside. He loved our nation and has built us a synagogue, built us a place of worship. When then Jesus went with them, and when he was now not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, sent friends to Jesus, saying unto him, Lord, don't trouble yourself. Lord, now that sure don't sound like us, does it? And we won't help you. Look, you come on, help me now. But this outsider said, Lord, trouble not yourself, for I am not worthy that you should enter unto my roof. Wherefore neither thought I myself worthy. Now y'all know we don't talk like this. Y'all better come on here. Y'all gonna make this sermon alone. You do know that sometimes folk outside the church got a much better attitude and spirit than those of us who are in the church. Lord, I thought I was not worthy to come to you, but watch this now. Brother, we can preach 6 weeks right here. The outside said, but saying a word. You ain't got to come all the way up here. Just saying a word, Lord. And this is the kind of faith I have. I don't know you, but I believe in you. Just saying a word, and my servant shall be healed. For Lord, I am also a man sent under authority, having under me soldiers. And I say to one soldier, go, and that soldier goes. And I say to another soldier, come, and he comes. And I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard these things, y'all remember Sunday morning? After all these things, when Jesus heard these things, he was amazed. He wondered. He marveled at him and the people that followed him. Now Jesus has got to have something to say. I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, not even on the inside. I haven't found this kind of faith in Israel. And they that were sent returning to the house found the servant whole. Lord, how many of you have time? You do know there's a difference between being healed versus being made whole. Now, I make my confessions on Sunday. I'd much rather be whole than just healed. They went back and found the servant whole that had been sick. I really do want to talk a little while tonight. I say I really do. Usually when I say a little while, it just be preacher talk. But I really do want to talk a little while tonight from the subject, the phenomenal faith of an unbeliever. The phenomenal faith of an unbeliever. Now, let's have two quick points tonight. Number one, outside of faith that exceeds inside of faith. This is directly from the testimony of Christ. Yes, sir. And then when we prepare to close here tonight, we want to look at the second point. The challenge to us as insiders is to not allow outside of faith to exceed the inside. The challenge unto us tonight to not allow folk who are not in covenant relationship with God. That's good to see you, brother and sister Drain, tonight. It's a challenge for us tonight not to allow folk who are outside the body and the church of Christ to exhibit and have and show more faith than those of us who are on the inside. Contextual setting and situation of our text under consideration here tonight finds Christos Kyrios, the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In this text of Luke chapter 7, he had finished his saying. That's just another way of what Matthew had spoken about in Matthew 5 through Matthew 7, that world-renowned Sermon on the Mount. When Jesus had got through with all that pristine teaching in his sermon on the mountain, you know, telling folks like, think not. Come on, help me here tonight. Jesus doesn't just tell us to think, he tells us how to think. Think not that I've come to destroy the law of the prophets. I have not come to destroy, but I have come to fulfill. Jesus taught them stuff like, you know, do good to them that despitefully you. I don't mean no harm. Sometimes you got to go outside the church to find folks who know how to live life. Well, I'm not going to go on yet. You see, Jesus had come down that mountain because we said last night that there is an axiom, there is a theory that whatever goes up must come down. And since Jesus helped multitudes of folk before he went up that mountain, folk were waiting on him when he came down that mountain. Now, on this, we said last night we were skipping over this centurion because we knew we were supposed to talk about this here on tonight. Y'all got time for this? I'm going to try to get us out of here before we have to go put the party here on here. If y'all help me, we'll get on down from here. Almost thought I was in another place. You talking about getting on down, I was getting ready to quote Luke's accounts. But he said, I want all the hip kids to gather around and get right in front of your radio so you can get on down. Preacher, you need to get on down from here tonight because this water ain't running. The young folks are sitting there going, who is Luke Sicard? Hey man, those of us who got a little years, we used to be fun. know George Clinton and William Bruce Collins. You might want to Google that when you leave. Yeah, well, honey, I thought you were all right. I don't know about you now. Look, Jesus came down that mountain. And when he came down that mountain, there was a man. Y'all got some beautiful smiles on there, baby. There was a man who was under auspices of the Roman Empire. And he was a centurion, which means he was in charge of 100 Roman soldiers. And this centurion had a faithful, well-beloved servant in his house that was sick. And he couldn't do anything to help him. And he was not just sick, he was nigh unto death. I don't mean any harm now. When you get that sick, you need more than a physician. You need a good physician. And you see, there was a healer in town. There was the best doctor in the world in town, but the centurion didn't know it. Boy, if we had time tonight, I'd extol the virtues. There's a whole lot of good teaching in that. But we ain't got time. Rather, there's a whole lot of good preaching in there. But you see, the visiting preacher always tries to encourage the church that if you want to do well in this life, you got to know a whole lot more than the Bible. You got to know people. Isn't it interesting how some folk know a whole lot of Bible but can't get along with anybody? Isn't it interesting how some folk are very knowledgeable, but they're all over the signposts? This man didn't know Jesus. Yeah. But he knew folk who knew Jesus. Ooh, if we had time tonight. My father, that's my mother's husband, y'all, taught me when I was a little fella. He said, boy, now I don't draw it. That's a term of endearment. Since I know when we were raised in a time when somebody older could call you a boy, you could draw up. I don't know what's wrong with us now. Let me get back to my son. But my mother's husband, that's my father, y'all. That's my sister's daddy. He said to me, boy, you don't have to know him in everything. Peter has said, sometimes you just need to know who knows. Oh, you gotta know when to say amen. Some of us think we know everything. But you know, what we really know is a little something about a lot of things. But there's not a single one of us that knows everything about everything. He didn't know Jesus. But that wasn't a problem. Because he knew the folk who knew Jesus. He needed help. And he needed the world's best physician, but he didn't know it. But he really didn't have a problem. Because he knew folk who knew Jesus. Now watch it. As you know, as influential as a man as he is, he didn't have a pride problem. I mean, he's a centurion. If he tell a soldier, get on down, man, what the soldier gonna do? Get on down, man. If he tells a soldier to come back, that's what that soldier's going to do. Ooh, he's going to come right on back. Isn't that right? And so when his servant, whom he loved, was sick, he asked the elder. Y'all come on here. But we need to know influential people. And we need to cooperate with the leadership of influential people. Because sometimes when we can't get to who we really need, sometimes influential people can get that far. But if we know a whole lot of Bible but don't have any social capital with people, when we need trouble, we're going to really be, when we're in trouble, rather, and need help, we're going to be in trouble. Amen. Because we have an issue with sociodynamic relationships. We know a whole lot of Bible, but we can't get along with nobody. Lord, I gotta move on here. There's some of us in the Lord's church, and when other folks see us coming, they go, oh, Lord. And then when they opened their mouth, we said, oh, not today. He had a servant who was sick. He didn't know Jesus. But he asked the elders, go talk to Jesus for me. Ask him to heal my servant. Guess what the elders did? Be lying. They went right to Jesus. And watch the testimony. The man that sent us is well. Look, you have him. Now, he's not in covenant relationship with you yet. Ooh, I got it wrong. See, sometimes we dismiss folk. Because they're not in our fellowship. We count folk as unworthy. And we count folk as we shouldn't develop. Look, life is all about relationship. You can't even teach somebody the gospel. Folk don't want to know what we know. They want to know how much we care. And when they know how much we care, they'll let us share what we know about God. What's the testimony? The man who's asking for your help, Lord, is worthy. We want you to help him. Now, Jesus didn't have to ask any questions. They volunteered. Why, the man? This man has built us. He's built the Hebrew. It's going to be quiet in your church, right? He has built the Jew. He's built us a synagogue. If it were left up to some members of the church would go right up. Exceed 10%. For what? We not under the law. See y'all pull on the preacher's cape tonight. Don't pull on the preacher's cape. Look, the tenth was in place before the law. Amen. When Abraham went over there in order, warned back, got back his confused nephew. Young fella. Amen. Allow the green grass to fruit. Thought all that good was gold. Abraham had to go over there and whoop some folk and bring him back. But on his way, he met Melchizedek. Genesis 14, king and priest of Satan. Amen, y'all. And then the Hebrew writer in Hebrews 7 says, consider how great this man was, whom the father Abraham gave a tenth of the small. What if you left up with some other church with the white brother? Do you know that the average person gives 3% or less than that gross income to the church? I'm going on to the judgment. I'm here. I'm ready to get in. Oh, it's quiet in here. Oh, I know who get on down. Look, I don't mean any harm. Guess how much of this stuff we got in the world we're going to take the judgment with us? Sad on. What sense does it make to allow what God blesses us with to come between us and God? What kind of sense does that make? As a matter of fact, he doesn't need any of it. Because he already owns it. Job said, naked came I into this world. Naked I'm going out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the seed. A lot of us are all right when we receive it. But what about when the Lord kind of takes some things back? Job said, shall we receive from the Lord? Yeah. And not sometime be grieved to deal with difficulty? Yeah. Amen. If folks said amen in here. Yeah. We got to learn how to be deeper than shallow. Shallow. So let me close this. What had happened was, they said, this man is worthy. He built us a synagogue. Now that was some Jews that didn't even contribute to the synagogue. And ain't nobody stealing. to a denominational church. You got some folk that even when they miss church, you know what they're saying? I say, my God.
When the man saw that Jesus was coming,
Amen. Because ambassadors came to the house. Man says, no, 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 look. You go back and tell the Lord. You go back and tell the Lord, I'm not ready. Tell the Lord, don't put yourself out. Don't go to all of this trouble. Look, I got a whole lot of faith in the Lord. You don't got to come way down here to my house. And you sure don't have to knock on the door because I'm not worthy. I'm outside. Amen. They went back and told the Lord what the man said. Then the Lord turned to his people. He said, I have found this kind of thing. In the house. This stuff is outside the house. And I haven't found this kind of faith in the house. Guess what the man said there? He said, you go back and tell the Lord, you don't have to come down yet. Come on, y'all. Just say it. Closing now. How many times are you going to say that till I get through? I'm closing now. You see, you don't believe it? How many of us in here either work on a job or have worked on a job and retired? Raise your hand. Now count on your experience. You know, sometimes people, they like to lay football off. Oh, it's quiet in here. When we win the nomination of church folk will be raising the roof right now. Sometimes when they want to lay folks off, it's called a job action. Listen to them denominational folk. Guess what they said? Y'all come on, help me. Just pray about it. How long we got us? Oh, it's quiet in here.
$5.
$5 for a dog, and he came out the other side of his tent shaking his head, he sure right. Sure right, I ain't never seen that before. The other five, you know us, don't you? Tight cheek. Well, what did you see? He said, no, you want to see, you want to pay your $5. One of the other fellas paid his $5, came out one of the tent, so he sure right. I've never seen that before in my life. The other fellow said, man, what did you see? He said, look, man, let me tell you what I saw. I went under that tent, and they had a wagon under that tent. And that wagon had a handle. And there was a rope tied to that wagon. And two of our folk had their hand on that wagon. And they were pulling in the same direction. I've never seen that before. Is everybody all right in here? We are riding the ship. God's own ship of God. And we all need to be rowing and pulling in the same direction. And we all those of us who are on the inside. Now, if you're outside of this old shepherd's life, and you say that you have a whole lot better attitude and a disposition than us, I'm not going to argue with you. But I will encourage you to do what you must do, be saved.
Yes, sir.
Amen. I know this is, there are some people that will never read the Bible, but they'll watch our lives. That's why Paul writes in the church and says, we are epistles read of me. Amen, y'all. We are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its savor, wherewith will it be seasoned? Oh, Lord, until we get ourselves right, we got to point folk to God. Jesus said, Lord, I come in the volume of the book to do thy will, O Lord. If you want to be saved, sometimes you got to stop watching us. And you got to watch God. God has done for us what we could not do for ourselves. God, chapter 8 and verse number 3, sent his own son. And the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. Died on Calvary's knee. Died for the sins of the world. You are hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:1-4, Paul says, I deliver unto you first of all that which I have also received. Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. He was buried according to the scripture. With glory, hallelujah, death couldn't hold me. Sunday morning, he rose. I wish I had a big thing of keys in my hand. I'd just take them. Stood on resurrection ground and said, I got the keys to death, hell, and the grave. Tell my boys to meet me in the alley. I've risen just like I said I would. That, no matter how we act, that's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. And those who come to God got to do two things. Hebrews 11:1-6. First of all, we got to believe that he is. A rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Sometimes we need the disposition of those on the outside. We need to know how to diligently seek the Lord. Second thing you have to do, after hearing that gospel, you got to believe him with all of your heart. John 8:24, Hebrews 11:1-6. Then we have to do the hardest thing there is to do. That's why you can't watch some of us. Some of us ain't changed nothing since 1969. Some of us don't know about changing and repenting. We just gonna be like we are. And then we be proud with it. That's who I am. That's what my great granddaddy was. That's how my great grandmother was. That's how any and all. Come on. Come on. our lives. You know what the three most used words in the English language is? Are I, me, and my. Personal pronoun. We need to be talking about the Lord. He died for our sins, buried and rose again the third day. We heard that gospel, we believe it. Now we need to do the hardest thing there is to do. We need the word to fall on good soil. Not that barren, hard ground. We got to learn how to soften our hearts. Amen. We got to learn how to think different than after we've talked, after we've been talking the way we thought before we talked. Then we got to learn how to change and turn to the Lord. And then when my brother starts to sing tonight, you need to walk down here and confess with your mouth what you already believe in your heart. He's denied it to me. I believe that Jesus Christ, he is the Son of the living God. Submit to water baptism. Acts 2:38 for the mission and say, well, but preacher, I've been baptized before. That ain't no thing. Anybody that was baptized was baptized based on their teaching. And you can't get the right baptism if you didn't get the right teaching. We have to obey from the heart the right form of doctrine. He that transgresses and abides not in the doctrine of Christ has not God. Soften your heart. Stop trying to defend things you can't even find in your mind. Do you think you want to go to judgment trying to defend somebody, something, or some church that was never in the mind of God and never made it to his word? That doesn't make good common sense. Who was quiet in here? We have to learn how to do this. Speak now, Lord, and thy servant will hear, heed, and obey. That's how that works. We have to soften our heart. Amen. We have to allow our spirits to bear witness with God's spirit that we are the sons and the daughters of God. Hear the gospel to thee. Repent of your sins, confess his name. Be baptized in water and then wash your sins away. Acts 22:16, he'll add you to the church. Acts 2:47, he'll add you to the church. Acts 20:28, that he purchased with the shed of his own blood. Here's a Christian sin that separated us from God. 2 Corinthians 7:10, sincere and godly sorrow works repentance. James 5:16 follows, we confess our faults one to another. We pray for each other that we might forgive us. The effectual fervent prayer of the righteous avail much. One last time, the phenomenon of faith of an unbeliever. Sometimes faith manifested on the outside exceeds faith manifested by those of us who are on the inside. We have to commit to God, commit to our Savior. We want to take this challenge to never, ever allow outside faith to exceed the faith of those of us who are on the inside. If there's one of those standing in need of the Savior's invitation, we can come right now. Together we stand, and together we sing. He, sweet I know, the Lord is sweet. Oh, he, sweet I know, as strong as strong.